Praise the Lord, Elder Fran. Praise the Lord, everybody. Good evening, good evening. Oh, give thanks. Thank you for that song, Elder Fran. Praise God, it's good to see all of you. Praise the Lord, God is so good. And you know, as I was preparing for this series, I just, you know, I asked the Holy Spirit to take full control, right? You can have a gazillion notes, but you want God to flow and you want him to have his way. And so what I was feeling tonight, as I looked back previously at some of the last few videos or the last two videos, right? I did a lot of talking and I always say, oh, I'm not going to talk as much. Well, I'm really not going to talk as much tonight. This is where we're going to be participatory because we have talked about gratitude. We have talked about thankfulness. This is our last session on thankfulness and gratitude. And we talked about intentionality, being an intentional about gratefulness and gratitude and the benefits of it. We not only talked about the benefits spiritually, but there are benefits in the natural. And we know in all of our lives, there are probably negative people, you know, who focus on, I love what Elder Fran said, that's so perfect, the glass half empty or the glass half full, right? We probably all know somebody like that. And the people who focus on the glass half full, there actually have been so many studies, you know, and when, I hate to say this, but sometimes when people are unaware, right? Ignorance isn't bliss in this case, because when you are a negative person, and when you are negative, and when there's not a lot of gratitude on and not a lot of gratefulness, it shows up in your health, right? Science has shown that. And I gave you some statistics. I was looking for my notes on that one. But essentially, it was saying out of the people that they did these studies with, and there's been a gazillion studies, like there's Christian studies about spiritual wellness, and there are natural studies about gratitude and gratefulness. Right? What does a person look like when they show up as a positive person? What does a person look like when they show up as a negative? And as I was reflecting on the science and just what I know, I think about the people I have come encounter with, the people that have been so negative and so, as Elder Fran referenced, the glass half empty. Like I see the misery in their life. It shows up in their faces. It shows up in their movements. It shows up in their being. You know how people say, I can't vibe off that person, or I sense their vibe in the room. They're truly sensing what that person is, because we all are beings, right? We all are, we're soul, we have souls, we're mind, body, and soul, right? We show up as something, right? And the essence of who we are, even before we open our mouths, comes out. I think about that person I had told you, her perspective in my industry, and maybe many other industries too, our Mondays are really, really hectic. And it's been that way. Like Andy and I joke, he didn't realize until I started working from home, the power, how powerful it is on Mondays, where just it's like everybody's flipping out because the world has come back from a 2-day stint of being off, right? And so they come back on Monday and now everybody's ready and it's go, go, go. It's what we call the grind, right? The grind happens. People are complaining or they want what they want. They want it right now. And what happens is I see the Monday fever. And this woman, I remember in particular, I shared with, I think, this group, she used to call it Manic Monday. And I had to rebuke her. And I told her, you can't say that around me or in front of me, especially not if I'm the leader. I'm not going to accept that. It's going to be a marvelous Monday, right? We're going to work it out. And if you really want me to get spiritual on you, because she knew I was a Christian, I'm going to call it Manifesting Monday, right? Manifestation means that the glory of God is going to be here. So that takes us into a whole spiritual realm, right? But I didn't want to get all crazy Christian on her, right? But I did talk to her because she knows who I am. We've been together now for 4 years. And so she knows the essence of who I am. So under me, you're not going to do manic, right? You can say it behind my back. and that's fine, but you're not going to say it out loud to me. I'm not going to allow that. That's negative talk. Even if I weren't a Christian, I still wouldn't allow that, because that's not how I show up in the world. That's not how I think about things. I am that person that's the glass is always half full. Like, I see it as, this is like, we can get something from this, right? Even if it is a really overwhelming situation. So tonight we're going to talk a little bit about that. We're going to reflect on what we learned. I'm going to go over some new things, but we're going to be intentional, right? And I've been doing this with other groups. We're going to be intentional in what we do specifically here tonight. So welcome, Pastor Pelham. I see you there. Praise God. Good to see you. Good to see everybody. Let me just pray over the word. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, I thank you that you are an awesome God and you are worthy to be praised. I give you the praise for today. I give you the praise for GTOMI, our leadership, Pastor Pelham, his wife, God, and all those that are in ministry. I thank you, God, for the corporate body of Christ. I thank you for your word, because your word doesn't go out void. God, it does what it sets out to do. So I thank you that it will fall on good ground. I thank you for what you have given me for this group. Have your way. Hide me behind the cross. Take full control, Jesus. Have your way in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise God. All right. So praise God. I did want to, Elder Fran, thank you. Listen, you and I are in one accord tonight, my sister. I'm going to start off with a 4-minute song. It's already 14 seconds in. Thank you before, again, I'm being very intentional about what we're doing here tonight. I want you to listen to the words.
Tragedies are a common place. All kinds of diseases, people are slipping away. The economy's down, people can't get enough pay. But that's on me. Thank you, Lord, for all you. In the street, and drug habits, some say they just can't beat. Oh, muggers and robbers, no place seems to be safe. Lord, but you've been my protection every step of the way. I'm gonna say, thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Hey, it could have been me. Me. I
Hallelujah. Thank you for your love. Yes, thank you for your power. Thank you for protection every hour. I think sometimes we not, you know, I'll say, I don't want to, you know, classify because I don't know who, but sometimes we forget and we take for granted the things that God has done for us. And it's so important to have that spirit of gratitude because there are people, as her song says, that are homeless. It could have been me. It could have been you. There are people that are gone now. It could have been me. It could have been you. And so we have to really be intentional. As we talk about intentionality in our Christianity, right? Intentional. With the spirit of gratefulness, with the spirit of gratitude, with the spirit of thankfulness. And over the last couple of weeks, we have talked about how to do that, whether it's through journaling, whether it's through music, whether it's through certainly seeking God's word and reading his scriptures, finding scriptures that talk about gratefulness. And when you're feeling down, when you're feeling out, when you're feeling lonely, going to God's word, because God's word transforms our thinking. I shared with you, you know, over the challenges over the last couple of months, we as a church went through with losing Elder Lee, the challenges many of us have had personally, and I know I've had personal ones, and I've really had to exercise what I believe that who I believe I am, understanding that purpose, who God created me to be. When you have that spirit of gratitude, it teaches you to glorify God in everything. And so to the point of looking at things from a positive perspective, I know many believers that will say things that are very negative. And they come off the cuff with just the negative thing without even thinking, because truly that is in their heart, as the Bible talks about in Proverbs, right? God purposes in our hearts. He gives us purpose, but we get choice on what we choose to say, how we choose to approach life. So when we talk about intentionality, we talk about doing things with intent. And last week, when we spoke, and I think every week, I reviewed in the beginning, you know, the definition around thankfulness and gratitude, right? Thankfulness is that emotion, right? And listening to that song, it brought me to a level of emotions of just feeling gratitude for all God has done for me. And I loved, I don't know if it was last week or the week before, and the answer that stayed on my heart, there were two answers, responses, and I'm going to start off with Brother Prince after I say this one comment. It came from Brother Enoch, and his response was, I'm thankful for the things I don't have, right? So I can appreciate that, because in thinking, we know what God has given us, and maybe we have requested or prayed about, or asked God for other things, but he didn't give it to us. What if he gave it to us? What if, you know, as you think about the things you wanted, you know, let's say, I don't even know what, you know, I can't say for you, but what if you were a billionaire? What if God gave you that because you prayed for that, because you wanted a certain amount of money? Where would you be? Would you be a good steward? Would you be faithful to God? Would you have the lifestyle that you have now? What if you were the CEO of some major company? What if the things you prayed for, what if, you know, you were in perfect, perfect health and you never got sick? Then would there be that opportunity for you to know what God has brought you through? What if? And so I resonated with Brother Enoch's statement. It hit me like a rock. I'm grateful, God, for, and I can say this, and I've said this to my husband, the man I didn't marry, because I don't know where I would be. He's doing well now, but I saw the journey of his life. And I remember reflecting, wow, I dodged a big bullet on that one. God, thank you for allowing me to listen to your voice on my purpose partner, the right person for my life. If I would have married the wrong person, what if? I know I wouldn't be, listen, I might even be dead, because that's how volatile our relationship got, right? What if I didn't live in Boston and I lived where I really wanted to live, New York City? What if I lived there? Where would that have taken me? So I'm grateful, God, for the things that I requested of you that you did not give me. What if? And so I do think that we have to be grateful for what God has given us. So when you show up, I give the example of what I just shared with you about that Monday, that person saying manic Monday. When you show up at work on a day that's manic, you've got to be grateful for that. You can't, again, as believers, I'm not, you know, non-believers, it's a different story. They don't belong to Christ. So they don't see things from the filter of Christ like we do. We come in giving thanks. We come in giving praise, right? Our hearts have to be receptive and open to that. But how do you do that? Because we all have a background. We've all come from somewhere. I know I'm not the same Margie that I was in my earlier years in Christianity. In many areas of my life, and I still have growth, but I thank God I'm not where I was before, because I could be very critical. And, you know, that was just how I was. God had to teach me, dial it back, daughter. Dial it back. I'm going to teach you this. And it related to, it wasn't that I wasn't grateful, but I realized it would take me down when I got very analytical and almost very critical. And my husband, I had to learn this through him. I could see things from a different lens, and it wasn't the lens that God would want us to see it through. So I learned to stop saying things that would, because the enemy knows, the Bible talks, the Bible says in Proverbs that death and life is in the power of our tongue. So I wouldn't put it out there. I stopped. And every time I wanted to say something that I felt wasn't going to edify anybody, whether it was in the natural or whether it was in the spiritual, I wrote it in a journal. So I could see my own progress. God wanted me to see my progress. He wanted me to see my heart on paper. And so when we practice our intentionality in being grateful, we have to understand what it means, right? So the thankfulness is that emotion, and the gratitude is an attitude of appreciation under any circumstance, right? So the gratitude, it involves, and sometimes, you know, in all my readings, you know, many of the scholars say that, you know, for Christians, those two words cross, right? Because gratefulness and thankfulness, we begin to worship God and praise God. So the gratitude involves being thankful. It's that expression, the appreciation, but it's doing it day in and day out, when nothing exciting is happening, when it's just average, when there's tragedy, right? Because when the exciting things happen As we know, at Christmas, it's easy, right? Our kids and people who we give gifts to, and when we're giving gifts, oh, thank you, right? You're so excited. But what if no one gave you a gift and they only, I don't know, gave you a hug and said, this is your Christmas gift? I don't know. I'm just making it up. Would you be, oh, thank you, thank you? Would you say thank you in the same way that you said it for a actual gift? So what's our perspective as we think about who we are as believers? And, you know, it's to that part, it's funny because I told my children, stop buying me gifts. You don't have to buy me gifts. Like, I have everything I need. I have you. I have the love of my family, the love of my church, the people that are connected. I'm good. Like, and if you pick up something for me, it may not be something I want. So I'm good with just you telling me Merry Christmas and giving me a hug and being with me. Your presence is that present that I appreciate more than anything else. I'm grateful for that, right? Amari and Ayana this year, they bought me a gift. They bought me these earrings that were Afrocentric and they lost them. And so I could see how, like, they came in the house and Ayana was distraught. And I'm like, what's the matter? She's like, I can't believe it. We don't know where we put this bag. It's okay. I'm excited you're here. That's my gift. Like, really, come on, guys. Let's get a perspective here. I'm good. I'm good. So that gratitude, we talked about this last week. It glorifies God, right? The scripture I came from, and I'm going to give it to you again because some different people are here today. It's 2 Corinthians 4:15. And God's grace reaches more and more people, there will be thanksgiving, and God will receive more and more glory, right? So the attitude of gratitude, the attitude of giving thanksgiving is one we do as believers. This alone is our reason to give thanks, period. Because it touches other people, because we've been called to touch other people, right? It glorifies our God. It exalts not the gifts, but the giver of the gifts, right? The giver of life, the giver of everything we have. Gratitude helps us to realize, right? All we have has come from above. And it's not because of us, but it's from God because he loves us so much. So I'm going to stop right there because I didn't do what I said I was going to do. I want to finish off what we talked about last week. And I had asked Brother Prince, one of the exercises we did, and we're going to do an exercise tonight, and then we'll go back to the word. One of the exercises we did was writing in the chat again. We did it last week, 2 weeks in a row, practicing our intentionality on being grateful to God. And we wrote in the chat, and we'll do something like that tonight, but with a little different twist. We wrote in the chat, for those of us that could use the chat, why we were grateful. And I talked about the tools we can use. I think as I begin to really practice gratitude, and I didn't just do it because we were doing this lesson, but I started doing it when I purchased, and I had done it over the years, but I really intentionally went and purchased a gratitude log called Gratitude Log. And I started cataloging that for many different reasons, for, you know, reasons that are going to relate to what I want to do next with the information that I pulled together in my log. And I'm dating it. And I'm writing what's going on in my life in the sequence of when I write what I write about what I'm grateful for. And again, I'm going to hone back into Brother Enoch, because there were times in the log that I was grateful for stuff, but tragedy was happening. And I still said, thank you, Lord. I'm grateful for this, even though tragedy is here. And I'm experiencing tragedy, and I'm going through this, and I'm going through that. And we never know what a person is going through. We just, you know, because they show up and they look like they're okay. So when we tell people, I'm going a little bit off track, but I do want to say this. When we tell people we'll pray for them, when we tell people we'll fast with them, when we reach out to people, and or we tell them we're going to be consistent with reaching out to them, we need to hold fast to that. We need to stick to what we say we're going to do, because it relates. Eternity is in the balance. It relates to somebody else's salvation. It relates to their well-being. And Christ hasn't put us here to be alone. He has put us here to encourage, to enlift, uplift, to inspire one another. Yes, there are times when we're going to be alone, but there are times when we need that encouragement, that inspiration, that care, that love. Sometimes it's just a hug. Sometimes it's a smile. Sometimes it's a text. Sometimes it's a phone call. And if you're doing it consistently with someone, you do that consistently and you don't stop. The enemy knows what people need, and so does God. And so when we practice, we were talking about last week what we were grateful for, and the week before, and we had, you know, comments like our families, and, you know, I loved what Sister Des put, a comment that was just to walk, to be able to walk, right? Some people may take that for granted. Our gratefulness came from, loving on our church family and those connected to us, our gratefulness for life, our gratefulness for our peace, right? Our gratefulness for God's power, our spouses, right? We all had various answers. And then Brother Prince wrote made a comment about what his gratefulness and moments of thankfulness. And Brother Prince, I'm going to yield my mic to you to talk about, I wrote a little bit of what you had written, the constant the static process that we go through, being constant and a non-static process in our moments of thankfulness. So I'd like you to share, Brother Prince, if you could. And I yield my mic to you.
Okay, thank you. Trying to remember that comment, or try to recreate what the comment is.
Okay,
I remember. So what I mentioned last time was just thinking through the process, and didn't really just want to write one of the things that come to mind immediately, but just to really think through. And like you, Elder Margie, I've made it a practice over the years to just write thoughts down and to go back and look at them and so forth. So what I thought about to be grateful for is the journey that of life, you know, of experiences or things that you go through that shape you into the person that you are, right? And I mentioned that one of the things I think we do a lot is that our gratefulness or thankfulness comes from these static moments, right? So if this happened, then I'll be grateful. Or, you know, if that happens, then I'll be thankful. But what we don't realize is that because we are on a very ongoing journey, an ongoing process, those moments aren't very static, right? They're very fleeting. So if we just rely on that moment when we are happy, you know, we're happy for this moment, but then 2 seconds later, that moment has passed. Will we be grateful a minute from now? But what life is just really a journey of moments, right? Like for every moment that happens, it's new. And I think if we develop the attitude that for every minute that passed, we are experiencing something new, and we can be grateful for those things. And even if there's tragedy or disappointment, you know, the whole phrase, this too shall pass, right? We do know that if for this moment we are going through something that is hard, and we have to acknowledge that, but just know that the next moment we are being, I use the term perfected, right? In this journey, in this walk, then we could be grateful for what lies in that next moment. And one of the things that I use as an affirmation, and I'll just read it real quick, is something that I use for health affirmation. It's from Martin Luther, that preacher guy. And what he says is that life, therefore, is not righteousness, but growth in righteousness. Not health, but healing, not being, but becoming, not rest, but exercise. We are not yet what we shall be, but we are growing towards it. The process is not yet finished, but it's going on. It is not the end, but it is the road. All does not gleam in glory, but it's being purified. And that means a lot to me, because when you think about something like health, right, we are thinking about this fixed state, but it's about healing. Every moment of our life is about healing. When we talk about righteousness, we want to think that we're in the state of righteousness, but it's becoming righteousness. It's an ongoing process. So I think in any one of those pieces, for me, gratefulness is looking at the journey and to give thanks in those new moments and those new experiences that are constantly shaping us, and not just some static moment that might have passed or what we are looking towards in the future, but just the moment in itself. That's the gratitude, that's the gratefulness. And so that's what it means to me, just the moment by moment and experience by experience, how does that shape me? And I'm grateful for each of those moments, good or bad, indifferent. It's just the moments that we get to experience. So I think that's kind of what I was
mentioning. And I love that. And Pastor, I don't want to pass you up. So if you'd like to say something related to that or respond in any way, you are welcome. You don't have to, Pastor. I just don't want to miss you this time.
I was listening to Prince there, and that was powerful. And it's, Martin Luther, he's one of the guys that, I kind of look into, like a little dabble into some of his things sometimes. And he was certainly, an anointed and separated man of God. I believe that. As I was listening to Prince, one of the things that came to mind is, which comes to my mind usually, is that, as the Apostle Paul has said, he said, whatever state I am, I have learned to be content, you can't do that without being grateful. And as far as myself, I am grateful even for the mistakes in my life that I've become aware of, and through the journey that God has brought me through. It hasn't been easy, but I understand why, God is so awesome that, he brings us through every step. Each and every day is another step in that journey that we walk with him. And, the other thing I like to mention is that I believe in my heart that no matter what happens in the course of my life, and I would hope that others would believe it also themselves, that God doesn't do accidents. Nothing happens in our lives accidentally, and nothing happens in our lives that God is not going to bring us through. And ultimately, whatever happens in our life is just another opportunity to grow. So I thank God, for everything. I'm able to thank him for, even the difficult times, and another thing you mentioned earlier that I wanted to mention about was, what was that? And you were speaking on, what would happen if I got the things that I want, and that's another thing that I thank God for, because, there's a lot of things that I desire. There's, a lot of things that, I haven't received, and I'm all right with that. All right. Because, I truly believe that that there's a point where God will give you what you need for that moment and that time, and anything beyond that, God will not give it to you because it may be something that you can't handle right now. OK, God's not going to give you something that's going to move you away from him. And what it made me think of was Proverbs 30, and I have it right here, Proverbs 30 and 8. It says, remove far from me vanity and lies. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me, lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and stale and take the name of my God in vain. I don't ever want to be in that place. So with me, keep me in the middle, okay? I'm all right with that, okay? And if the middle isn't what other people would expect of me or what I should have, well, that's all right too. But I'm satisfied wherever God has me. And I believe that God has me even right now in this very moment where I should be in life. And I am grateful.
That's good. Thank you, Pastor. And thank you, Brother Prince. I didn't know if you wanted to say anything else, Pastor. Does anybody else want to respond to that before we move on? I do see, thank you, Brother Prince. It's powerful that we as believers, as we begin to explore gratefulness. And I love the fact that Brother Prince has, whether it's an affirmation or statements about gratefulness. I think, again, in our intentionality, we've got to, seek these things out. You know, certainly as Christians, we have biblical affirmations, but there are also affirmations from philosophical people, affirmations from people in our lives that affirm, you know, whatever is going around us, right? On around us, people who are just positive that might not even be believers, but they just come off on the positive tip because that's who they are. In looking at the world and the view of the world. And again, we know that what science has showed us. And so when we speak of the gratefulness and the thankfulness, right, it's our response to God's favor over our lives, right? Our hearts are filled with gratitude for his blessings. I know last week or the week before I was talking about the song we sing, count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them, you know, name them one by one. So we can just rattle off as we begin to be thankful and grateful. Again, the intentionality, even in that song, right? The power there is to be grateful and thankful for the things that God has done for us, where he has brought us to. I've written here, although gratitude means thankfulness and gratefulness, our response is God's favor as we receive it, right? It's a much deeper response where our hearts are filled with gratitude for his many blessings. So it's sort of a repeat of what I just said, right? Our hearts are so filled up with what God has done for us. We see in the book of Psalms where David was a man after God's own heart, right? His heart was always filled with praise, even though he was in, you know, situations of dire stress. Many times he put himself, like, listen, there were consequences for the decisions he made, but even in that, even knowing who he was, right, as his own persona, and I can't tell you, I haven't studied David enough to know how he was thinking, but I know he knows he messed up in things, but even in putting himself in these situations, he was still grateful for how God had brought him through, how God had brought him out, how God was always beside him. He understood the power of God in his life, but he knew, again, the consequences for some of the decisions that he made, right? He, you know, in many cases could have said, God, I can't deal with this. You know, why are you taking me to this? I can't thank you again. But instead, he came with that spirit of gratitude, right? Because it was something he didn't earn or deserve, right? And we know that the Bible talks about that even when we sin, God's grace is restored to us. And so as Christians, we have to be intentional as we strive to be more thankful to God for everything that he has done for us and he has done in our lives. In Hebrews 13:15, it says, by him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually is the fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. Listen, that's a mindset. You know, as I learn, as I've been on this this last year on this entrepreneur journey, I can't tell you how many times every time I'm in a room, the word mindset is used, because it is a mindset. And I see the power in it, especially with entrepreneurs. I may have been in leadership all my life, but there's really a different level of thinking for those that have their own businesses. And it is a mindset, right? And so for us in Christ, as this scripture in Hebrews tells us, that should be the fruit of our lips constantly before we open our mouths, right? Before we come with this, you know, if we're feeling a certain kind of way, then rather say it, remain neutral. If you can't say something positive, remain in a neutral stance, so that when you do come forth, it's something truly from your heart, truly from the perspective of thanksgiving. And why? Because the word of God tells us that, right? So you have to become disciplined. If you know who you are and you know that you've always taken that negative tip, or you've always taken the glass half empty, or you're sort of in the middle, sometimes you get a little weary and you get, you know, you come off with this negative, then you've got to discipline yourself, because you hear yourself saying it as it comes out. Halt, stop. Don't function from your reactions. And as I'm saying that, I'm going to give you one of the things that if for those of you that are taking notes, and maybe Brother Prince, you can write this. And one of the things that I have learned when I was learning about purpose, when you make decisions, right? There's something we call HALT, H-A-L-T, right? And it does, we know that it means to stop, right? But the acronym's HALT. So, you know, because we function off of our, who God has made us to be, our emotions, right? We come and we may be angry about something, right? So when you're making these decisions and when you're getting ready to respond to people, it's you stop. And you use these letters to remind yourself. And the letters stand for specifically when you're hungry. You know, sometimes when people are hungry and, you know, you're getting ready to say something and you're just like, I just want to get my food. So you're like dismissing people or whatever. Don't let that emotion override you when you're angry. And I know a lot of folks that are in the sports arena, my kids and many of their sports friend, right? I've heard them say hangry. When you're hungry and angry, right? And you're getting ready to respond to something, don't do that. Just take a minute, whether it's you need to get food, when you need to step back because you're angry about something, stop, right? And then when you're lonely, right? When you're lonely and then you're speaking to somebody, I saw a post, I saw several posts on Facebook from someone, and this person was sort of going off on people because they weren't responding to her. And it was like nasty responses, like nobody cares about me. Nobody's going to come get me. I'm sitting over here. I need food. I got family out there. Well, right? You're right now I'm by myself, right? You're lonely. So now, right now you're reacting in the emotion of that, right? Instead of being in the spirit of gratitude, thank you, God. And I get, you know, if that's the reality, because that is the reality, maybe they are lonely, then do something with that. But don't put it out there to accuse other people, right? To put this negative post out there that's going to make people either feel bad for you, right? Or, you know, whatever it is, or, you know, put them on a guilt trip. It's one thing if you're telling a story to explain why you are where you are, what the situation may be. Right. For many of us, we heard on the day that Dr. Laverne came, right, we heard one of our sisters express, right, her discontent about, you know, the disconnection. right? She told a story, right? That's her story. We can't change that. That's her story. And I appreciated Pastor's response to that, because there is a response. Just like when I saw this post for this person, I'm like, wow, I'm sitting here thinking, and I responded to that person by picking up the phone. I'm like, I'm just going to call her and tell her what I'm thinking right now. I'm here. So if you're lonely, you don't have to put a post out there to make everybody and their mother feel guilty. I'm your relative. Pick up the phone. I'm here for you. And I will come where you are. I will pick you up wherever you want to go. I will take you. And, you know, and it was funny to me, because then the person started making excuses. You live far away. I'm like, I will drive to New York for strangers. So if I'm going to drive to New York for strangers, I'm going to drive an hour or 2 hours for you. Are you kidding me? You don't understand my personality. You can't post something like that and be connected to me and think I'm not going to respond. And it might not have even been for me, but you put it out there for the world to see with no context. So if there's no context, I can't even respond back to you, but I'm trying to understand you now. So I'll take you to the supermarket. I'll take you to wash your clothes. I'll take you wherever you want to go. So what am I saying here? The spirit of gratitude. And actually, that is where I was trying to take this person, that, you know, I'm grateful that you even have a house, where you live, you have a place to live, you have food. I'm grateful. And now you have somebody, because you said you had nobody. I'm telling you, I care about you. So now you have somebody that cares about you. So H-A-L, and then the T is tired. When we're tired, and I would say this again, maybe this group might not be, but I use this with my kids. Like, do not post when you are tired. Do not post when you are angry. Do not post when you are hangry or hungry, because you're just going to be in your emotions. Stop it. And if you're going to post at those times, you've got to give context, right? And there's a whole protocol around posting, right? Sometimes people do it intentionally. I've never used social media like that, and I won't. That's just not me. I'm not going to do that. If I need to say something to somebody, it will be said. And that is just the end of it. But again, that's my generation. I can't expect for other generations to function like that. They, you know, this generation especially has social media. So the word H-A-L-T, it means something. And so we should caution ourselves as believers, right? When I spoke to you just now about the mindset, right? And we look at scriptures about mindset. It is our mindset. Our mindset should be a mindset of gratitude before we go out there and start going off on people and throwing darts, right? And if you want to do that, you know, again, if it relates to one specific person, go to that one person. Stop that as believers. Don't let the enemy use your post to make people think that they're, you got a whole group of people, a whole something going on, right? I don't mean to go down this way, but I want to say that to the body of believers here, the way Christ has called us to address our issues is to go to one another, right? It's connection, it's relationship. You don't have to be afraid of me. I don't have to be afraid of you. Yes, life is that. There are hard conversations to have. Listen, that's part of life. There is going to be conflict in any group you're a part of, in any network you're a part of, in any business you're a part of. If there's more than one person, there is going to be conflict. If there are two of you, there's going to be three of you, four of you, five. There's going to be something at some point. Yes, you're not always going to agree, and you shouldn't. God has made us all different. To be different people. And we just figure out how to deal with the conflict. And that means we have to try to, and I love, again, Pastor's response to a difficult conversation. That was a difficult conversation. it's difficult to hear, right? People don't like to hear things that make them feel a little, and even for us in receiving what was being said, that was difficult for me to hear. Then I had to give it context, right? When you start giving it context and you put the timelines together, you come up with your thought process. You come up with your responses as Pastor did. It's the same as I shared, you know, we go through and we talked about this in the months of October and September, right? We talked a little bit about forgiveness and church hurt, right? The first 2 years my mom was went into Smithfield Woods, it was hard for me. I felt alone. And the loneliness was real. Like, you know, people, we're going through a pandemic. Everybody's scared. You know, so I understand that. And it took growth on that. It's not to accuse anyone that no one showed up. It's not. It's to say, that's the story. That's how these things happen. I'm grateful for all and thankful for all that are still connected with my mom and still do whatever they can do. But the bottom line is there were 2 years straight with pretty much only a few visitors. And that, of course, that hurts as an only child, but it's not to accuse people. It's not to blame. Of course, the enemy would try to do something with that. We were going through a pandemic and it's hard. When somebody, and I understand this now, even for me, I had to learn, right? And Andy reminded me, hun, it's the disease is tough. You know, there were days where you didn't even want to be around your mom because of the dementia and what it did to you, how it sucked in your spirit, how it made you down, how it made you cry, how it made you depressed. So if you, the child, feel that way, how much more? So I gave it perspective. It was mentioned that when the comments came out at that meeting, well, some people might have felt bad. You can't, yes, you have an emotion and a reaction, but it's a party of two. There's a responsibility on each side, right? And same for me with my mom. Right? There's a responsibility on each side. So that's your story is your story, but you got to put it to context. And then you've got to give, and this is, I really pull this piece in. It has to be grace that we give as the believers, because God gives us that. He gives us that grace and he gives us that mercy, that level of understanding. I didn't understand it in the beginning. No one's calling her. No one's not even show. No one, maybe pastor, right? It's hard to receive that. Again, no blame or condemnation to anybody. That was the experience. I can't change it because that was the true experience. But what do we learn from that? What I learned is we all go through. We all handle things in a different way. There are challenges. And so I learned in those years to be grateful for every single action, every single connection that happened. Even when, you know, simple things like when Sonia would just go and do her hair, I was thrilled that she would have somebody else in the room besides Andy and I, right? Again, no condemnation to anybody else. It is what it is, and it was what it was. But understanding that the level, I began to thank God for his goodness and his mercy to all of us, knowing he's got our back, right? Knowing that I've got to learn. And I think it was, for me, that's where I really took to writing more. And being very cognizant of what I would say and having Andy to talk with me about it. I had somebody to really, you know, sort of give me another perspective. And then the word of God made it very clear to me, crystal clear, about his grace and about his mercy. So I think we've got to remember those things as we, you know, live this life out. So God's grace, it was something, and this is talking about the King David, it was something he did not earn or deserve, even when he sinned, right? Even when he wasn't doing right, he saw God's grace restore him. And that's Psalms 34:1. Let's just quickly read that. I want to put our eyes on it. And there's another Psalms 107:15, but we're going to only read 34:1. If you have your Bible, you can go there with me. And Pastor, if you'd like to say anything after I read this scripture, you can. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth, right? This was when David was going through, right? People didn't understand, but again, being grateful, I will bless the Lord at all times. A-L-L. His praises will continually be in my mouth. I'm reading at the top. It says, this is when David, he pretended madness from Adonijah, who drove him away and he departed. So he was being driven away. And he still said, I will continually praise God. His praises will be in my mouth, even as they come at me, right? Even as things don't work out, I am still going to give him thanks and praise. The spirit of gratitude. Pastor Pelham, I yield to you if you'd like to say anything at this point.
All right, praise God. That's one of my favorite psalms there. You know, I love how that psalm starts off, especially knowing David and all that he had went through. You know, and it starts off that I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. And I like the part where it says, my soul shall boast in the Lord and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. And what he's talking about, he's talking about every part of his being. You know, will bless the Lord at all times, not sometimes, not when things are going right, you know, but even when things are going wrong, when things don't seem to be going the way that I've planned them to go, when things are not happening my way, when it seems like everybody's against me, when it seems like everybody's talking about me, lying on me, whatever it might be, I don't care what it is, I will bless the Lord at all times. I will give him praise. His praise will continually be in my mouth. You know, so I praise God for that, because that's the attitude of gratitude, okay? See, because David knew God. And when you know God, you know, you can have that attitude of gratitude, you know, at all times. And you're able to praise God in the midst of the storm, you know? Even though it's difficult sometimes, I've seen people, just dropping buckets of tears and really hurting, but what was coming out of their mouths was, thank you, Lord. You know, there are people that can give God thanks in the hardest times of their lives, you know. So what I'm trying to say is that, you know, giving thanks to God, as the Bible has says, is that this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning us. So no matter what it is or whatever we're going through, you know, we ought to give God some praise, give him thanks, because God has been good to us. I praise God for that. I sent something a minute ago, and, you know, Prince kind of encouraged me to go to one of the people that, you know, I kind of search out his preaching through the books that I have and stuff, because I've always been, for some time, I've been, you know, someone that liked Charles Spurgeon, all right, in the way of his preaching. And Charles Spurgeon is actually called, they call him the Prince of Preachers. And what he did is he had a quote on, you know, being grateful, you know, the joyful gratitude. And it was very short. It was, the greater our present trials, the louder will our future songs be, and the more intense our joyful gratitude. You know, praise God. So, you know, it's not the trials that we need to run from. We need to endure them with the help of the Lord. And as we realize that God has helped us through it, yes, the more intense our grateful, our joyful our gratitude will shine. So anyways, praise God. I thank God for the Bible study tonight. Sorry that I was a little late, you know, I'm glad that I made it. And before I forget, come the 18th and stuff, I won't be with the Bible studies. I'll be back with the school again.
Okay. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you for that comment. And thank you for sharing that that quote. I love that quote. It does, listen, you know, that certainly resonates for me. But it does tell us we're going to have some situations, right? We're going to go through, but we have future songs to sing. And then we have the gratitude, the joyfulness of the gratitude. For the last 5 minutes or so, I want to take and use one of the tools that I got through working this whole gratitude curriculum. And it's just a questionnaire. Actually, there are two of them. I don't think we'll be time. So I think this, we'll try this first one. It's just 5 questions. And Sister Helen or whoever, I guess maybe the easy way, we can use the chat if we want, or we can use our, you can use unmic and just say it one person at a time, whatever works. I'm going to ask you a question and you're going to answer it. And you're only going to have like 5 seconds. What am I doing here? It's a grateful questionnaire, right? And so when you practice gratefulness, you already have those things in your heart and on your mind, right? I'm going to go back to Brother Enoch's comment. You know, as I thought about, and Pastor, what you said, the what ifs, right? What if I didn't do this? What if I ended up here? What if, right? I'm grateful, God, that you didn't allow me to go down that pathway, take that street, marry that man, right? So so whatever is in your heart right now, and again, Auntie Helen, you can, if you want to unmute, because I know you don't use the chat, you can, or you can just write these down. Again, I'm not going to give you a lot of time to do it. I don't want you to think this is not a quiz where you're going to get a right or wrong. This is just, I want you to just come off the cuff and come out your heart. Why are we doing this? And again, it's, you need to be honest with yourself. If it takes you a long time to figure out why you're grateful for something, then I want you to think about that. And I want you to be intentional the next time, or as you're, you know, going through your daily life, what things, like Brother Prince said, I love that, in the moment, what am I grateful for? Listen, I ate a chocolate bar today and I ate it like I had never had chocolate before. Okay. I kind of chuckled at that. I was like, man, I said to Andy, 2 days without chocolate. And I'm like, this is like, it's so good. And I didn't want to share it with anybody, right? It was something that little, but I was so like excited about the chocolate bar with nuts. It had nuts. So anyway, here we go. Question number one. I'll count it out. I'm only going to give you 5 seconds. You either put it in the chat or you say it out loud. I am grateful for my family because. I am grateful for my family because. You can put it in the chat or you can write it out. I'm giving you more than 5 seconds. Here it goes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Second question, something good that happened to me this week. I'm gonna write mine on that one. So you're getting more than, something good that happened to me this week. I am grateful for my friendship with a line. Who are you grateful for your friendship with? So Helen, I hear you. You can say it if you want.
Well, there's two really. One is Rhonda, Sister Rhonda Dean. She's always there when I need her.
Yep.
And another one is Elder Jackie, whenever I need someone to talk to.
Amen.
I'm grateful for them.
I love that. Okay, next question. Something silly that I am grateful for. I put mine in the chocolate bar. Something silly that I am grateful for. And I'm going to read these quickly after. And finally, something else that I am grateful for. Something else that I am grateful for. Elder Fran said, what is the correct question? All right, I'm going to read the answers. So the first question, thank you, Sister Des. She numbered hers. All right, I like that. But okay, I am grateful for my family because she said they are thoughtful. Sister Donna said they accept me for who I am. Sister Fran said they are who God gave me. I love that one. I don't know, Elder Fran, I find that funny. But that's a good one. Yes, I'm grateful that way too. All right. I'm grateful because I got my chocolate bar. All right. The second one is something good that happened to me this week. Sister Donna said I was able to work without feeling ill. Praise God. That's a big one. Elder Fran said I woke up. Yes, amen and amen to that. Pastor Pelham said another day. Amen. Brother Rudy said, because I was born into a family that knows Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. Sister Des said, I had a restful day off. Amen. All right. Then the next one is, I am grateful for my friendship with, and we heard Auntie Helen, Sister Helen say, Rhonda and Elder Jackie. And Elder Fran said, my sister. I'm assuming you mean Sister Cheryl, right, Elder Fran? I didn't see her. Okay. Yep. All right. Sister Donna said Jesus Christ. All right. Number three is I am grateful for who I am because Sister Des says my friend. Oh, wait. So number two was, I'm sorry. I am grateful for my friendship with Sister Des said my friendship with my sister cousin Michelle. Amen. Number four. I am grateful for who I am because that I can smile and mean it. That's good. Yes. Amen, Sister Donna. Brother Rudy says, singing in my car or the shower. Amen. Praise God. Sister Donna says, I don't know if this is to the same question, my hearing. Maybe that's to the next one. Something silly. That wasn't silly, Sister Donna, right? Which one did that go with, Sister Donna, your hearing? Unmute yourself. You got to unmute yourself.
Okay, I'm saying I'm grateful for my hearing because if I didn't have my hearing, I wouldn't be able to be listening to this message tonight. So I'm just very grateful for my hearing this evening.
That's good. That's good. Amen. All right, I like that. Let's see. They support me through it all. I got a good report from my doctor, Jesus, my hair, and my husband. Are you answering all the questions, Sister Denise, in that? Okay, so is your hair the silly one? Okay, all right. I'm grateful for my hair, too. Listen, you can buy anything. So I'm grateful. Number four, all right, I'm grateful for who I am because I am grateful for my new, Sister Des says, I'm grateful for my new PJs, something silly. Okay, that must be that one. Elder Fran says, God is answering my prayers for my husband no matter what I see. Amen, amen. And let's see, number five. Something silly that I am grateful for, right? Oh, wait, or maybe this is something else I am grateful for daily, to be able to walk, walk in pain in all. What do you mean, Sister Des? To be able to walk without pain? Are you there, Sister Des? Okay, I'm not sure about that one. I don't, and then sorry, I couldn't keep up, still using one finger. That's okay, brother. Elder, that's okay, Pastor. And then Brother Rudy says Jesus, and then we kind of, let's see, I am grateful, who this, is this from you, Sister Denise? I am grateful for my son, and a son bought me a 50-inch TV, yeah, and they came tonight and hooked it up, okay, that I can even walk if I'm in pain. I hear you, Sister Des, yes, that you have, you know, I my mom used to say that before, that, you know, we are in pain, right? She was in pain in her legs. And then she was reminded of the man who had no legs at all. So again, that spirit of gratitude. Well, thank you all. That was a fun exercise. I just want us to remember the spirit of gratitude. Jesus Christ lives within us. We have some scriptures to keep us going. We have one another. Let's be thankful and grateful, not just in this season, but at all times. And I thank God for each and every one of you. And I yield my mic to Elder Fran.
Let's give the Lord a praise offering. Praise God for Elder Maggie and the lesson.